Pauline?
Maybe you can come to the office and we can hug ourselves and we get a bit warmer. I'm happy to see you, first of all, because I know that you are working very hard on the final presentations. But I think it's an important day because it's not very often that we have a talk and a visit by not only a mayor, which is of course an important thing, but also a kind of, let's say, partnership of a city with an industry that they are working on real future urban proposals. In this case, based on mobility planning, but they will be really talking about the vision behind different new city services and new planning ideas for our urban environments. So I'm very happy to present to you today Giuseppe Curtatone, who is the mayor of Somerville. He's very young, as you see. I have read that he's the second youngest mayor in Somerville, but one of the important challenges of the mayors today, with all the current, let's say, challenges that we're dealing in our cities, it's becoming very interesting to be a mayor in such a very important moment. So Giuseppe has been working hard in an open-minded way, and he managed to place Somerville into a reference city around the globe. Actually, Somerville has won many awards and distinctions. The best run city, grand city in Massachusetts. What else do we know around MIT and Harvard? But the one of the 100 best communities for youth. So also how the social aspect of the urban environments is also included in such reforms and new programs, as well as Somerville has been the winner of the 2009 All America City Award. So it's great to see that we have you here today, and you are actually joined by Christian Gärtner. So on that hand, we have the industry, let's say, part, no, the company part. He's the CEO of the Urban Standards. Urban Standards is a platform for dealing with consultancy in mobility. They are working on mobility revolution, they call it, but also combining this mobility consulting with software development and urban planning. They are working on different projects around the world, in Somerville to start with, which is what they will be talking about. But I was very interested to see what you were discussing about the topic of today, because we're at the moment that, you know, I always say that the car and the elevator have been the two elements that they have influenced the typology, the morphology, and the process of contemporary urbanization. So they are representing now here today the car culture. But we're at the moment that we are all criticizing the individual mobility. There is a lot of work, there are a lot of cities that they are taking a position of cars, no? The cars are bad, the cars are contaminating, the cars are occupying public space, the cars makes us waste a lot of valuable time. I think that what Joseph and Kristen will be talking about today is a kind of an alternative point of view of how can we work with such a problematic and see it as an opportunity. I think you're calling it a kind of rejective culture or something like that, restrictive culture. But how, instead of thinking of policies related with restrictive tendencies, we can really work with the possibilities of the individual mobility and combine as well new technologies for coming up with innovative ideas about the mobility planning and consequently urban planning of the areas. So this is what we will be talking a bit today. Thank you very much, Jason and Christian, for being here. Please help me to welcome them.
Thank you.
So, thank you for being here and to all the evening, everybody. Thank you to the IAAC and thank you to you, Arita, for not only having us to invite you, but also for being like giving us the opportunity to discuss our project within the master class. I think that was a great opportunity for our project, for the Audi Urban Future Initiative, for the Audi Urban Future Partnership, but also for Somerville. Because I think we have a lot of challenges we are in Somerville, and with the car we were just mentioning that before. And I'm especially happy because our last meeting here in Barcelona was exactly 3 months, 4 months ago, and we presented the work of a year together with the city of Somerville and the Audi Urban Future Initiative, and it was exactly about the issue. The car caused a lot of problems. The car was maybe the most important innovation in cities in the last century. So how do we put the car back into a more sustainable way into our urban redevelopments, and how do we like learn from cities what the car or the mobility, as they would put it, could become part of the urban sustainability again. But let's get started, and I think what we do first is to show a small video, two videos, and the first one is on Somerville, and I think you did that with maybe you say just
If I understand this video, first of all, it's great to be here with all of you, and thank the Institute for having us. The teams today presented the three projects, but fascinating and intriguing. Very abnormal, which is what we like in Somerville. I just want to say, as we see the video and have a conversation, I believe in the greatness of cities. Cities are incredible incubators of innovation and creativity and culture. And as we all know, by 2050, 3/4 of the world's population live in cities. So the cities is why I'm so passionate about thinking about mobility. The cities that can think and plan and build that future and take on the legacy challenges of mobility, health, housing, sustainability, those are the ones that succeed. So I'm excited to have this conversation with all of you, and I thank you for having us. I think the first video, I believe, obviously talks about Somerville. It might have been the Harvard Kennedy School. Let's see what it says.
This is Somerville, Massachusetts.
People used to say you're from Somerville. And I grew up with that name. And then that reputation goes back to, I'd say, starting mid-century when we abandoned the rail systems we offered it. Streetscape started to become dotted with more blighted and undesirable uses.
It was known as being corrupt and being this place where nobody wanted to be, and it was a little sketchy.
Somerville has a really amazing past, and bad things have happened here, but it has this wonderful, wonderful soul.
If you want to rewrite that narrative, we had to do it on our own.
What the city has done is it has changed the relationship between people who live there and themselves. It really has fundamentally changed. Instead of being a place that was kind of the armpit of New England, it has become a place where every 29-year-old is desperate to want to live there.
Professor Domus and I met each other in November of 2003. I had just been elected mayor, had not yet been sworn in.
I was describing a lot of the best practices of real leading cities.
At the end of the day, I approached Professor Domus and said, hey, these are the things I'm talking about today.
But I'm broke. We have no money.
How can I and future administrations work with the opportunities? What we saw was an opportunity where the city could be an experiential classroom for the students.
Where those who have already taken the introductory or intermediate classes can actually work in the real world.
Since then, we've been on a decade-long relationship that has resulted in many reforms, innovations, and incredible results for the city of Somerville.
Well, everyone was incredibly welcoming when we came into City Hall as a student group.
My department heads and agency managers, rank and file employees, incredible experience.
We can really maximize customize our work by teaming up with these student partners.
Right off the bat, we reviewed the whole budget document.
It wasn't as transparent, it wasn't as obvious why we're making spending decisions.
Didn't say it was aligned to the goals and objectives that we all raised.
It's now an award-winning document that residents understand, the mayor understands, and our heads understand. It's used as a prop on Parks and Rec. Leslie now pulling it on us, like, here's our town budget. Yeah, that's one of our proudest moments.
And over again, over the last 10 years, we've had similar projects. Budgeted customer service on specific capital projects.
The biggest impact is that this school has infused us with a data-driven approach to government. We've made overhauls to how we think about traffic and parking and customer service there. We've made decisions about how to deploy meters and whether or not to build community centers.
It's put in a 311 line. It's put in a performance-based budget. It's put in, it's managing using a STAT program, the summer STAT program.
All based on input from students.
A funny thing is that a decade ago, none of my students actually lived in Somerville. And now, because it's Somerville, it's become such a hip place, actually quite a few of them live in Somerville.
It's really inspiring to be here and see how engaged the community is with the government and with the community.
When we look at the United States and we look at the challenges and the scale of our problems, it's very difficult to understand how those things are going to be fixed. And the reason that Somerville is so important is because Somerville is an example of how really good management, really good analytics, and really good leadership, all the things we teach at the Kennedy School, can actually transform a city from being a basket case to being something really well run.
The community has risen up and said, if you want to know how you create an exceptional place to live, but a world to play to as a family, you look at something.
So there was a lot of information, I think, and it leads to the first question. You know, Joe, you were born in Somerville, like you grew up in Somerville, you're since 12 years mayor of Somerville, if I'm right. And I think you started a lot of projects that are turning Somerville into an urban lab. What was your idea behind that?
So I don't know if you can, because I tend to talk a little fast. And probably, Somerville was actually known as Slummerville when I was growing up, and it was a reputation that we earned. Not too long ago, if you wanted to learn how not to do things, how not to manage a city, how not to institute some progressive policing policies, how not to plan for the future, you would come to my city. So much of what we're doing today, which drives my passion and curiosity, is rooted in that reputation of a failure, a missed opportunity. So I grew up in Somerville as a son of Italian-American immigrants, and it was always a great city to be in because of the most important aspect of the people that were there. But as Professor Billness was describing the city's relationship, it was very gritty, it was very corrupt, it had no narrative, it had no future plan, and we defaulted to this reputation that wasn't so pleasing to listen to. So I think we had a sense of resiliency and civic pride that we always fought against that reputation. So when I became mayor, and actually when I first ran for office 20 years ago, I've now been in public office 20 years as a local legislator to mayor, my passion was to change that narrative, but not just in words, in action.
And we look at Somerville today and look at the demographics and the social structure of Somerville, I think we find kind of very interesting mix of people because we have at least like a 50% of millennials in Somerville, so it's the second richest town of millennials in the US, and we see a lot of bottom-up movement, but on the other hand, we see a lot of urbanization, urban redevelopment around Somerville. What is this kind of pressure you are in, and how do you feel that kind of, there's on the one hand this young crowd that wants to change the city, on the other hand, there's the economic pressure of gentrification. How do you deal with that?
It is a challenge. So in the US, we already know what will happen. The city reaches the world by 2050. In the U.S., we're in the midst of the greatest demographic shift in our nation's history since about mid-century, since about when Somerville started getting its reputation. In the mid-50s and 60s, there was urban flight. People were running from the cities. They're too dirty, they're unsafe, they're corrupt. Now there's an incredible shift to run back to them. You had millennials or the abnormals, or you have, you know, the you have baby boomers who are retiring to their urban dream home because people want to live in the urban core where they can walk, bike, you know, connected to good culture and lifestyle and the services they need. So how do we as a city, we ask ourselves, leverage that asset of who we are? And now, today in Somerville, we are much more diverse than we were when I was growing up. Again, I grew up in a neighborhood where most of the kids were immigrants. I was first generation born, my first language was Italian, but there were kids from Portugal, mostly Saudi Arabia and the Azores, from Greece, from Ireland. There's a strong social fabric. Today we speak 52 languages. One third of our population was not born in the United States. We're second per capita in the United States for artists in the community outside of only Manhattan. As you mentioned, the second largest per capita population of millennials, the Britain, one of the best places to date a nerd, they say. So that originality, that diversity, that creativity, our soul, the challenges as we can now are seeing and experiencing the greatest investment we've ever dreamt of in the city. How do you maintain that soul? How do you make sure that any one of you who want to come to someone or raise a family, start a business, have an authentic, genuine choice to stay there? So it's a challenge for some of you, so if you saw the image, we're closer to downtown Boston than most of Boston. And the Boston region is the second most gentrifying region outside of the Bay Area in San Francisco. Median rental prices are on par, even if not exceeding New York City. So how do you think about the legacy issues of attaining housing, the cost of transportation, the cost of living? Now that some of us are so attractive, actually people do want to stay there. The schools are improving, the quality of life is improving, but can they stay there? That is the greatest challenge for us. Will we lose our soul along the way? Will we maintain it?
And I think it was interesting for us when we started, when we were first coming to Somerville and discussing all the issues around Somerville. We were fascinated by the perspective that with the current mobility system that is heavily depending on the car, you could never achieve the goals of the community. So there was a classical clash between land use for cars, parking, streets, you know, all the kind of related issues. So if you want, as a community, want to achieve your goals, the footprint of the car needs to change fundamentally. But we're at the same time quite convinced that the car will be part of the mix, of the mobility mix, of some of it. And so we had a kind of target conflict. We began to discuss how to do that. And so for me, the question is, you know, the soul of the city and the modal mix of the city, do they relate?
Absolutely. I think not, mobility speaks to not just how we move, but how we live. You know, if you plan a city for just cars, that's what you're going to get. If you plan our communities and cities for the human scale, and try to understand how we reconcile the use of the car. And the experience of the car, which is why I'm so excited about our partnership with Audi, is changing so much. And how do we relate that to a human experience? How do we think about redefining and repainting the canvas of our streetscapes and connecting that to the car experience and to our transportation goals in the future, to biking and walking, and building that infrastructure and the needs of the human scale. So the car's not going away. It's how we think about the use of the car and the role it plays and being smarter in that technology. So for some of us, out of our curiosity to understand is how we're trying to discover our partnership with Audi is how this private sector innovation and technology deployment help us take on the legacy challenges of mobility in this case against the backdrop of urbanization.
And does this already affect, because I think there was an interesting case to talk about technologies and to talk about testing technologies in the urban ground, but what I think was very interesting is how your administration reacts on that and how your zoning code, building code, reacted on the kind of new understanding of technologies, both in public transportation, but also in environment. Maybe
we can give an example of that. Kind of local challenges that we still have, you know, is the changing culture. We still have some folks who believe you need a car for every bedroom that you have in a house. That's just not the case. We have over 30,000 cars in the city, only 4.1 square miles, so it's at about 7.5 square kilometers, and 78,000 people, the most densely populated community in the New England region. At one point, I think we were a world with 110,000 people, 150. We probably live in about 3 square miles. But we put such a focus on the backdrop of needing building more capacity so cars can park, rather than thinking about how we utilize smarter technologies and smarter policies to use our land area more efficiently. Somerville is going through an incredible transformation. We want to grow. We actually believe in density. We think we leverage density done in the right way. Embracing the principle of smart growth and transit-oriented development, understanding how mobility factors into how we grow and we live into our sustainability goals, and we think about that future. And Summer Vision, which is the city's comprehensive plan, and some of the students here read that, speaks to not just what we want to build, but how we want to live and who we want to be. And it talks to the areas of the city that we want to enhance, we want to conserve, and we want to transform. Mobility is interwoven into all of that, and understanding mobility and how to think of smarter policies for the automobile, for walking, for biking is informing our zoning goals, our health policies, you know, our housing policies, but tightly woven together.
So there are direct impacts of rethinking technologies in, for example, zoning codes. Union Square.
Absolutely, Union Square across the city. We opened up, I think I did refer to it, but the city as a laboratory of innovation. So Somerville is not a rich community. When I first in that video talked about leveraging a partnership or potential partnership with Harvard, much like we're trying to do with Audi, it was to open the city up as a test laboratory for ideas and innovation. Somerville is so dense, its street grid is so tight, it's so close to downtown Boston's diverse, its housing stock lends itself to be a perfect classroom to launch or test ideas and technology and to extrapolate those ideas to communities around the world. You don't have 20 million people in Somerville, sometimes it feels that way. You can get your arms around it, and we're at a time in the city where we're starting to repaint the canvas at Union Square and Assembly. We have the first real expansion in more than half a century coming through the community. With our mobility goals as a city, with our housing goals and our planning goals, it lends itself again for a great opportunity to teach worldwide lessons. And you know, how we move smarter, how we park smarter, and so forth.
And one very interesting element that I think it's, for me, it was unbelievable when we were there. We had public sessions to discuss impact of technologies. There were 200 citizens sitting in one room working for 6 hours together to imagine how your city will look in the future. So what is the role of the urban activism and of the neighborhood? How do you organize the public participation in these processes? Because often we see that with a lot of innovation cities, they are quite heavily top-down oriented and very much dominated by industries. But I think that was the perfect case here in Somerville, that we had a huge bottom-up movement. Maybe you can talk about, you know, how many civic activists we have.
I think if we exceed the country in any per capita, it's activists enrolled in Somerville. But that's a strength. You know, in my, as a local official, one of the questions of the day for government is, you know, how do we reconcile governance and management and leadership, which are all distinguishable, against, alongside with planning and vision and community empowerment? Much of what we see challenging, and I think around the world, and we've seen this to some different degrees, from different ends of the spectrum than presidential debates, is the challenge of social progress in the city. You know, how do you unlock social equity through better and smarter mobility and planning the community? What I mentioned earlier about it, you know, the call to question is, can we give you an authentic choice to be there? The concern many have in the city is, will they have a true choice to participate? and craft that narrative and that's really the future? Will they be able to be here, participate in that new local sustainable economy, or will they be locked out? In the United States, you know, we rank in the top of the world in gross domestic product, by the 16th in social progress. In fact, Somerville will be the first city in North America to develop a social progress index. Leveraging the community, empowering the community's poverty plan only creates a stronger alliance. Our city, and I find it an asset, they're very cerebral, they're very passionate about the issues we're talking about here and thinking about that future. It just creates a stronger alliance and a plan that survives and is sustainable long past I am there or any governmental institution or administration. I think it's an important part of what we do. Top down does not work in my community. I think it's a fading approach of government. I think you start to see the divide of social equity or progress in the demand from a grassroots level of people that have a say in wanting us to democratize that process.
And I think it was very interesting to see how that works and how this is organized in your community. And for us as an industry, it was very interesting to see that we can be part of the briefing process, that we can learn from the community what are their desires regarding mobility, for example. Because we have a lot of theoretical discussion, anti-car, pro-car, bicycling, walking, everything, but we never talk with it. You know, it's so interesting to talk to communities that have a diverse understanding of that question and to see the trade-offs between their aspirations and the realistic goals we can find together. And I think that was part of the very interesting part of the conversations. So coming to the urban redevelopment of Union Square, what are the main challenges in Union Square you can see in the moment?
So I think from the heart of the structure, it's, you know, we have a lot to do. We have transit coming in, we have major infrastructure investment that's needed, you know, north of $50 million in the center of the square alone. The community is very active, engaged, and this is an adaptive challenge both for the community, not a technical one. Is how do we align everybody's hearts and minds to a certain community value? And what we're trying to do is maintain the character characteristics of the square in the community. We want to make sure our local merchants have an opportunity to thrive in the new economy and an opportunity to stay in the void we did. And also for people who still want to live there or want to live in Union Square. Trying to align the community benefits along with the neighborhood plan and the other planning goals around mobility and infrastructure is a challenge. But we're making progress on that, I think, because we put the work into the hands of the stakeholders. I think from a technology perspective, we have a great opportunity in Union Square to rewrite the grid. You know, thinking about, we know that our development in Union Square will be intense, and with that as a consequence, we'll bring more traffic, because even though we're bringing in a new light rail transit stop, that's not going to alleviate all the congestion coming into the square. If we're building, creating more density, we have more technology and startup companies coming to the square, new industry, which is one of our community goals. How do we think and smarter around the mobility base? Making sure that our goals for biking and walking align with our larger goals and having smarter automobile use, more efficient automobile use in the square of the community. So as we plan out our streetscapes, as we build out our infrastructure, as we're discussing with you and Audi, can we manage congestion and traffic queuing in some of the major corridors coming from the square? Can we think about our biking and walking infrastructure aligns with that, and our transit node, you know, is the potential for what some of the students have proposed for an intriguing conversation for mobility hubs in the square. So there's challenges on many different levels, but I think that's one of the main ones.
And I think that leads to what we discussed today and in the last weeks with the students. I think what we need to think about is how to restructure the different mobilities together and how we intertwine them and how we restructure the on-street and off-street parking throughout the city. Because I think you may say, I think 37% of the city are occupied with parking and streets. So the restructuring of that then leads to a new possibility for the city of Somerville.
Agreed, absolutely. Certainly the parking. What we lack also in Somerville is open space. Only between 5 and 6% of the city's land is open space. one of the great challenges we have in our community is active and believe in the concepts of active living by design. We want people to go out and play hard and move more. Access to really good open space for the many different needs of the community, young and old, for those who want to age in place, for the millennials that want to get out and move, for kids who want to just recreate. It's a challenge. And when you have so little land there, you're maximizing your land at the highest and best use, but also creating more open space is a difficult challenge. So if we can utilize new innovations in technology, private sector technology, to park smarter, or maximize land use, obviously that will make more land available for our open space goals, which we believe the systems-based approach has a certain positive consequence on our health, on our well-being, on our sustainability goals. So that is all part of the conversation in Union Square. I think the backdrop of Union Square was certainly present the launching pad for the conversations on the other major development districts and the transformative areas of Somerville.
And if you look at climate change and look at this emissions, so high emissions have been a problem in Union Square and in Somerville?
In Union Square across Somerville. So the Boston region is the sixth most congested region in the United States. And our transportation system, and I'm one of the students at a great slide, is one of the first subway system in the Boston area. It is antiquated, it does not have a good standard of repair. In Massachusetts, we're still fighting against policies of those who believe that we should expand highway systems. And we know expanding highway capacity doesn't give you more capacity, it perpetuates congestion. Congestion is certainly an economic killer. The built environment, mistakes on the built environment have caused not just some will impede for economic opportunity, but also certain consequences in our social well-being and our health. High rates of respiratory illness, lung disease, premature death, because years ago, probably when some of us died in the end of the name, Somerville, not only had a lack of planning what we wanted, how we wanted to grow, but also in the transportation infrastructure. Interstate highways came in through the city, cut off the community, neighborhoods from one another, secondary arterials, dotted our landscapes coming around Union Square. They took away what we once had, which were almost 20 rail and trolley stops in the city. It was a city dotted by the trolley problem, much like San Francisco. And then came the automobile and the highway systems. So we were no longer multimodal, we were singularly modal as a community, because it was pretty dangerous to walk in Union Square. So that, certainly the increased congestion and the lack of management of congested engines, and one of the reasons we have several environmental justice zones in our city, has had a consequence on our health and our well-being, and has landlocked us to the point that we haven't been able to grow economically, despite Union Square being a mile away from the biotech hub of the world. And Kansas Square, despite some of it being close to the downtown Boston, the financial district, and the airport, and almost all of Boston.
So you're talking about the kind of new operational system for mobility. We talk about reorganization of ownership. We talk about the reorganization between the different mobility modes. And we need to think about a new mode of, we have to think about fuel-driven cars. We need to think about sustainable things like mobility, etc.
The world is changing, and changing rapidly. We know that. The automobile experience is changing. The self-driving car is not a fantasy. It will be here. We want to be a city that leads an example of policy for that. Smarter street grids that communicate with our cars to alleviate congestion is not a fantasy anymore. You mentioned technology, but our behavior of today's society is much different than it was even 15, 10 years ago. In Boston, the Boston area, there's a big debate about how alternative delivery service and Ubers and the Lyfts of the world should be governed or regulated, because we still think that everybody wants to take a regular taxi. That's just not the case. It's a different experience that users are looking for. So there's an opportunity to bring in new technology to meet the consumer demand of the populations living in our city. And certainly, some of them want to be at the forefront of those conversations. So self-parking, self-driving cars, better technology to alleviate congestion, create better land use, and a better customer experience is going to lead to a more sustainable, more efficient, and more economically driven community.
And we talk about mobility, that's just one infrastructure. How do you think about other infrastructures? Are you also approaching new energy systems? Are you for Union Square foreseeing a kind of new
smart city approach to that?
Certainly, we need to grow across the city. We, as a community, have made a goal that by 2040, we will be carbon neutral. Now, you can't be carbon neutral just by dancing around the margins. You know, important technology deployment using biodiesel and efficient electrical grids. And so those are all important, but it has to be bold. It has to be abnormal. In the Boston area, if you look at a map of the concerns and the impact of climate change and rising sea levels, major parts of Boston will be submerged in the water. Yet, we have those in the Boston area who think who rely too much on resiliency and adaptation rather than making the bold changes that will affect tomorrow. The worst case scenario is based on how we behave today. And that behavior needs to be turned upside down, on its head, right now. So, district energy components are certain things we're thinking about, and many, many other bold initiatives to help us achieve true carbon neutrality. Somerville is home to one of the largest green technology incubators in the world. Soon will be the world, right now in North America, called Green Town Labs. And we actually opened up the city as an experimental lab for many of those technology startups to understand how we can map out a true strategy to reach carbon neutrality. But as we're planning out our districts and our neighborhoods like Union Square, we want them to be healthy and productive. We want them to be smart and flexible and efficient. Going to be a sustainability in our community goals.
I think what was interesting to do today and in the last weeks when we were discussing with the teams, it was quite clear that Union Square won't be built in one day. It's a project of the next 20 years maybe. So how do we prepare ourselves to be adaptive for social developments, for ecological developments, for technical developments? I think that was one of the big question marks. How do we structure these questions of the future, and what are the kind of milestones that are really valuable?
So I think as a community, I invite everyone to look at Summer Vision. We laid out a framework of values that we want to achieve. It is dynamic and flexible and consistent to the values we want to orient ourselves with. We are oriented by one value to make ourselves an exceptional place to live, to work, to play, to raise a family. But aligned with that are other values on affordability, on mobility to shift all new vehicle trips by 50%, on bike and walk and transportation, to leverage the new economies of the maker movement and fabrication movement and technology movement in our city, to create a healthy community for everyone to live in, to leverage our diversity, our originality, our artists, our makers, our population, our cultures. I think when we lay out our values as a community, we're guided by those principles. It allows us a certain level of flexibility and dynamism that is important to change as years change, but certain consistency and predictability that we're heading in the right direction. It has to be that more than any static plan. A static plan is not going to be able to be adaptable to the future, but we're planning based on community values with a better opportunity and better rate of success to achieve.
So what we saw today is a was an inspiration in that direction for you to see how to intertwine the different infrastructures and the different values of the community to an overall perspective for someone.
Yeah, the plans we saw today were interesting. I'm taking ideas back from all three as I head back to Somerville. We're in the climax point of our discussions and finalizing the neighborhood plan and trying to understand what are the community benefits we want to achieve as developers coming to Union Square or the city. But what I was fascinated by one of the teams really knew Somerville, and I mentioned earlier you would have thought they lived there, and understood the, from a mobility perspective and context, the opportunity to unlock social equity, but also the need for social equity and value to be shared amongst many different stakeholder groups. So I found them pretty fascinating, very intriguing, and some great ideas to bring back to our conversations.
So, and I would love to take advantage to say they should come to the winning team should come to the panel.
Everybody, come on.
Thanks for the example. Okay, thank you. And then I would like to thank you for this question for the last one.
This movement will be maybe we'll have some co-working space or different kind of facilities. And all the mini hubs will be connected with the central hub because it's a city level facility. Also the function of street will change. This is the other situation of street where all kind of vehicles and pedestrians share the same space in the street. And with the implementation of mini hub and the creation of a kind of pedestrian hyperblock, crossing traffic will transit only in surrounding street and in the main crossing street. So the rest of the street will be only for resident vehicles or service vehicles. And the space freed up from car parking on the street will be a new space for community. So these are the possible uses of these new spaces for community. So the idea is, with a small intervention, a mini hub, we can free up a lot of space for community uses.
So introducing mini hubs was more about changing the movement pattern in the neighborhood. So from linear patterns to a more pattern based on pedestrian movement and bicycle movement. So we did intensity map based on the distances from mini hubs and the usage of different type of modes of transport. And then we thought it's few of the streets will be only for bicycles and for pedestrian movement. So,
this is a neighborhood we picked as a pilot neighborhood, and we identified one family house and also mini hub, and it's how could it be, how a possible scenario could occur. So this is a mini hub that serves a 500 meters diameter and serves 350 houses, 395 people, and almost 400 cars. But the main idea behind this is to create this mini hub to replace the space that used for parking on the street, but also to create areas, create spaces for local food production and energy generation. And also introducing the new facilities, it will create like this sense of place in the community where people can gather, because in parking garages and parking spots, people don't gather, but with this new introduction of facility in a neighborhood level, this will be a space for people to gather. And this is the house, typical houses in the Union Square Central area, with a family with two children, one was younger, the one was older. And so this is the mobility pattern before, where the husband goes to work in the car, and the wife works at house, she's at home office, and then she goes to grocery store, she picks up kids, and then one of the kids goes to kindergarten with a bus, and the other kid goes to school with a school bus. But through the introduction of mini hub, this mobility pattern will change in a positive way, because now the husband can just go to mini hub with a driverless car, autopilot car, and then go to work. And the wife can, instead of driving to the grocery store or kindergarten, they can just go to this mini hub, and you will be using less time car. Same with the kids, and with the introduction of it, depending on your group, if there's a kindergarten residence in mini hub, the kids don't have to go to in a remote location for kindergarten or high school, but they can go to this mini hub. So this was our sort of like final vision of how this mini hub could work within the community and neighborhood. And we think that it would really, with this mini hub, we believe it will create this like sense of community, it will enrich the qualities that Union Square and Somerville already has. And it's a part. Usually this mobility infrastructures is not a place where people gather, but with introduction of new facilities, it will be a place for neighbors and people can gather and innovate. Thank you.
So I think what was interesting for us, and I think we love that proposal for the idea that with these mini hubs and the hub system, you create a behavioral change, and this behavioral change in mobility creates social spaces, new spaces in the city. And I think that's very much in line with what the community is really about. Their own behavior leads to different urban structure and like helps to sustain what the qualities of someone are.
Yeah, I'm agree, and there's a truth in here that just simply captures it. The essence of a conversation. It's not just the hard infrastructure. It's not the hard infrastructure that makes a city great. It's the people that make cities great, and the social equity component of what you see here. The structures of mobility allow that bump back where people are. Not no longer blurs in the faces of automobiles passing by, but is the opportunity to engage and enable collaborative creativity in our neighborhoods and our community. That snapshot really captures it. We become just a community of hard infrastructure, buildings, and you know, mixed-use buildings and railway systems. We become very sanitized.
So I would love to open up the round of questions.
It's not a question, just following a bit what Joseph and Kristen was saying. I think that what is becoming interesting in your project, but also like the discussion that was happening before, is to start to understand that the urban infrastructure is not a detached element of planning, design, and thinking that is given in kind of an input of a disconnected engineering company or let's say development company, but it's becoming really kind of an opportunity to rethink how citizens can interact with it, no? And the mobility is one very, of course, important issue to deal with this, and I think that this kind of you have or we have is becoming interesting. But for example, the same one could also start thinking of other kind of infrastructures like waste management. No? This is the kind of a typical infrastructure that one would like to have very far away from the city. But what if we start rethinking that buildings can have a kind of a biomass plant, heart, the bottom of the building, and then this could like power up the building. I really think that the idea of rethinking how the urban infrastructure is being re-implemented into the urban fabric and into the community life, it's becoming very, very strong. And I do applaud all the work that's been done in Somerville, and I do applaud so as well in this kind of thing.
I do want to say a couple of the other two projects or team presentations are fascinating as well. Fascinating one about the adaptive reuse of buildings in Somerville. I remember when I first came to the office, we wanted to knock everything down and build everything mixed use. It became apparent to us, especially city-owned buildings, we start to lose that edge. You know, what I love about, like, the city-owned this building, it's got a certain soul and an edge to it. Union Square, if you've been to Somerville, there's another famous square called Davis Square. You'll see Davis Square is very hip. Actually, it's called Paris of Somerville in the 1960s. But Union Square has a certain edge that you sort of want to pay homage to. And one of the teams presented a fascinating approach to capturing fuel, you know, gas stations and other components of the urban fabric to recapture from anything from urban gardens or community gathering places. So I think connecting again the hard infrastructure to the greatest assets of people in the community, the soul of the community, is something you're rethinking in some of the future.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, guys. So I wonder in the context of driverless cars. I've seen your presentations online about a building with parking that's, you know, smaller than typical parking garages and that sort of infrastructure. But I wonder if there's any other infrastructural changes that you're planning in Somerville? And if so, what the evidence is that gives you confidence that this is going to be something that's worth doing for the next however long, 50 years?
So it fuels up curiosity as well. Having done the infrastructure wrong at least once, and now trying to unwind that whole ball of time, the infrastructure to do all over again, and launch a major investment. How do we even try to do much of what we're going to do with Audi and the AA Mobility Labs, with evidence-based approach to test the ideas and understand what the infrastructure we need to see to put in place and move forward. I really don't know. So I know, I think we know that is the future, and from a mobility perspective, we have not done it by some more than a half a century. We know the need for biking, we know the need for walking, we know the need for to use the density of the data we have more efficiently, to create spaces more for active living, and I mean, that's part of our journey of discovery right now.
You know, we, next to Somerville, in the Audi Urban Future Initiative, we had a course of meetings with German cities and German administrations, and you would be shocked. They are not prepared at all to what happens in the next 10 to 12 years. They say we plan for business as usual, and we are really like, we don't have any time to invest our brains into something else. And then we started the conversation and said, you know guys, you will invest 17 billion euro in the greater Munich metropolitan area into brick and mortar and concrete. But you're not thinking about what digitalization, what disruptive technologies will bring to your infrastructures. It's really high time to connect urban planning and mobility planning, and you should bring your urban planning director of the city, you should bring your innovation director of the city and the transportation in one table and discuss how to structure that planning exercise for the future. And I can say, we don't know how the future looks like, but we need to build adaptive systems. We need to understand where should we invest and where shouldn't we invest in the future. And we should incentivize public action to steer into the right direction. And that's exactly what I like with this approach of your colleagues here. Because behavior change of citizens leads to a different mobility system. And that's what public authorities often don't believe in. They say people want to drive cars, people want it to go like that. We don't know that. So we have to understand what the behavior, what's the aspiration of the economy, but also of the community, and how can we then adapt our infrastructures to that aspirations. And I think I love Somerville for being so open to that question. To start a conversation of planners, technicists, and really all the different investments that has to be taken. But you will see that not very often in communities like in Europe. And I like, we have Mr. Piquet in our community, because I think you can be very critical about what happened here in Barcelona, but it's a first approach to exactly prepare city to be adaptive for technologies and for innovations in the city.
I can speak to the United States anyway. We default to thinking of budgets and get point A to point B, and we don't think about how we're going to live as a society, how we grow our communities, what that future will be, the infrastructure in the U.S. You from the U.S.?
Canada.
Okay. we're not as progressive as even Massachusetts as we hold ourselves out to be. I tell people I don't really live in Somerville, I live on Mars. My community is a little different. And we love being at home. We have a passion for curiosity. We'll push that as far as we can. What part of Canada is curious?
Toronto.
Great city.
I have a question regarding scale. I don't recall you mentioning the amount of people that live in Somerville, but I come from a city called Bogota, and there's laws for cars that you can't use a car every day. And you said that one of the most important things is to change the mentality of people when they use a car. How would you say, how would you apply, I mean, sort of your aspect, what would be your advice to people that live in the cities and they're so large, Bogota's amount, it's about 10 million people live in the cities, much bigger. I just want to hear your opinion on that.
I think that's a very relevant question because what we are talking here about is maybe a kind of new way of thinking of mobility in areas where you have a kind of controllable situation. But with the Audi Urban Future Initiative, we looked very deep into the problems of Mexico City, and we worked together with the city of Mexico City and the urban lab in Mexico City. We focused our in the second year of our research in Mexico City. We focused on an area that is an affluent central business district, but you have to imagine that there are 240,000 people each day commuting to that area. So you have 270,000 people in total, and 240 of them are going by car, and you have an average. There are 1.2 person in average in each car. So how do you steer behavioral change in a city like Mexico City? And it was interesting. We with our partner Jose Castillo, we started a kind of donation of data. So we started to say, hey, please give us a kind of diary of your mobility, so that we understand where are you coming from. And we saw a lot of people are in the same neighborhoods, going from the same neighborhoods to the same places, but don't know each other. So, and now we approached the human resources managers of the big corporations situated in the central business district and said, hey guys, you have a problem, because your real estate price is dropping, and people don't want to work for you, because they don't want to stay 2.5 hours in the traffic jams to come to your place. So, you should see that the mobility problem is a problem of workforce, and the problem of the wealth of the company. So start to connect with each other and organize that the people are going together. That's exactly where we are at the moment. The companies will start to steer programs together to bring people that they connect with each other and go, maybe not everybody, but even if we come from 1.2 to 1.5, that will take 30,000 cars off. So that's exactly like this. You need to see, okay, where is your biggest leverage, and then address the leverage top down, but you need first to understand what is the bottom-up movement you could create. So you need to have the kind of behavior change on the mind of people. People don't like to stay 2.5 hours in traffic. I hope that is, that's an answer in some way.
Thanks for for sure, people don't like to sit for 2.5 hours in the traffic jam because they have nothing to do. But do you think it's relevant to think of how to make use of this traffic and this congestion? For example, if you have this whole traffic, we have almost 2,000-3,000 mobile phones which can be collected together into like one huge mega computer which can make benefit to the city. Or for example, just all the energy produced by the cars or the heat, why wouldn't that be made use of? Why wouldn't you think too much in the future instead of making use of that?
I don't know if in some way we want to make sure we get rid of the congestion, but it is, I think it speaks to how do we be smart. So you want to leverage a reality. Is that the reality we really want to leverage? I think, in short, yeah, I think we want to discover all of that. But congestion is such a social, economic, and environmental killer right now in the Boston area. I'm just saying we're realizing that it's the call of the day. So I don't know if it'd be intriguing and interesting to find out if they can leverage congestion for some other technological innovation or good. Sure, we always want to explore, right? But the emissions, the loss of productivity. I guess the question is, can you be productive while you're waiting 4 hours in your car and you wake up? And maybe that, but I think I still think the net would be more positive if we can find ways to relieve congestion and have better flow. It's just my thought.
I think it's an interesting question, because one of the technologies we are testing in new information system between traffic lights and the cars, and how to build a kind of bottom-up car2x network, but not wait until all the cars are connected. So it's a kind of, how do we do a kind of adaptive traffic management through communication between traffic lights and cars, and taking all the other modes of transportation into the traffic light system to give favor to buses, to understand the needs of walkability and bikeability. So there's a lot of discussion now about traffic management, how you can use traffic lights in a far more complex way. But to be honest, you can have as much indicators as you want, but in the end it needs to work and to create this kind of dynamic and intelligent way of steering traffic lights. We are trying to test it in Somerville. There are no predecessors to that at the moment.
So if we don't have any more questions, I'd like to take a moment to firstly thank everyone I'd like to thank Somerville and the mayor for being here today and for giving us support and for giving us an opportunity. I'd also like to thank Stylepark. Stylepark are the curators of Audi Urban Future Initiative. In particular, Catherine, Lisa, Christian, and also Sophie, Julius, and Emily, who can't be here today, but they all made this possible. I think it was thoroughly exciting for students of Masters in Technology to be able to work in a real case study, to be able to really visualize something that could happen. And this would not be possible without the support of the city and, of course, of our industrial partners. So thank you very much.